I have so looked forward to the session we're about to begin, because it brings together so many of the issues that we're seeing happening around the state and around the country involving student success. There are a lot of people out there talking about you and the work that you do, and there are a lot of people who are very supportive of the work that you're doing and trying to find ways to pull together the many threads that go into education and our work with students. Doing that in a more concerted, organized way that brings all the assets of the institution and beyond together is a difficult task, and more than any one person or group of people can do. It takes all of the groups understanding each other well and working together well. And so we thought, what if we do a session where we just get those people together in a room? Let's get several different perspectives together and talk about the issues that we're seeing that seem most to be driving the issues for community colleges and our students, and have a conversation about that. There are perspectives here today that you may be familiar with. There may be things that you aren't familiar with, but I can just about promise you there are perspectives that you've never seen in combination this way. And that often is where the power is. And so what we'd like to do is have that discussion now from three different perspectives, and then engage you in the conversation. And how do you hear what they're talking about from the point of view that you bring to the discussion? We have three people with very impressive backgrounds to speak with us today, and friends of our association, and we've been proud to work with them on these issues during the legislative session and outside of that context as well. Cynthia Ferrell is the interim director of the Student Success Center, which is run out of TACC, to help coordinate many of the initiatives, the student success initiatives that are happening in Texas. That come out of the legislature as well as nonprofit philanthropy to support innovation in higher education. Melissa Henderson is the Texas Policy Officer for Educate Texas, which is think tank the right word? It's an organization to develop and support policies that support the work of community colleges in Texas. Roberto Zarate, after a career with the Northside Independent School District here in San Antonio, is a board member for the Alamo Colleges and is the incoming president of ACCT, which is the National Organization for Community College Trustees. And he has been very active during the legislative session to advocate on behalf of our colleges for the Texas legislature. So thank all three of y'all for being with us today. I'm very interested in seeing an engaged conversation with our members about the work that y'all are doing, how it affects them, and how we can all work together to advance the cause of education for community colleges in Texas. Dr. Zarate, would you like to start the discussion and say what you're seeing from your point of view, and we'll just go around.
Good morning, everyone.
I'm being picked on this morning. I was over there gabbing with the SACS faculty over there, and when I got back to here, these two young ladies had decided that I go first. Now, that's wrong. There was no democracy in that decision, okay? Plus, my last name starts with a Z. I should have been last. Traditionally, I'm used to that, you know? So anyway, I'm just so excited to be on this panel. These young ladies are so, so important to the work that's being done in Texas. But I will tell you that my excitement comes from finally being in front of the people that really do the work. In my role as a trustee here in Alamo and at the national and state level, I can tell you that this has been a missing link in our understanding of the work that we do. You know, you get all enthusiastic about student success, and you advocate for it, but you never see what happens at the ground level. Now, luckily in Alamo, we have presentations from the staffs every month on what initiatives are being done at each campus. So that's very, very, very important. But let me give you an idea in terms of this movement. When I became a trustee 12 years ago here in San Antonio, we were only dealing with affordability and accessibility. The more kids we could bring in, the better. Okay? We weren't worried about success. And so as I grew in my trusteeship involvement, and as I got involved at the national level, it became very obvious that nationally, statewide, and locally, we were invested in failure. You know, when you have the metrics to look at in those days, and even now, there was a lot of failure. But a lot of people did not focus on the role of community colleges. And when we adopted the issue of student success, it became very obvious to me that when you disaggregate the experience, there are a lot of successes we don't talk about. There are a lot of issues that we address as community colleges, that you address on a daily basis, that we don't talk about. And some of those issues are, there are kids that come to us, or I call them kids because now I'm 67, I can call everybody a kid. But anyway, when those students come to us, they come to us with a variety of purposes and intents. They don't come to us in the traditional manner, which is, I'm 18, I'm going to college, and I'm going to get a four-year degree. Some come to us for just like, I'm going to try a course or two, see if I can do this. Some come to us at 40 or 50, I'm going to Spain this year, I want to learn some Spanish. You know, or you have some of the students that come in the summer and say, hey, I'm an A&M, but I get better service out of the community colleges in Blinn than anywhere else, so I'm going to Blinn. And so all of those those metric points are negatives for us because there's not a completion aspect to that, okay? But one of the metrics that really resonates with me is that if you start out in a community college and you transfer to a four-year institution, those students do better than those native students that started out with that four-year institution. Now, what does that say about your work? I think it says volumes. And so my commitment and the commitment of the trustees, not only here in San Antonio, but statewide and nationally, has grown because of the work and the foundation you've based that way. And so how does that translate in terms of decision making? Everybody worries about top-down decisions, and I'm at the top, supposedly, in the structure of community colleges. Well, do you have the policy procedures or the policy structure in place to make sure that you're allowed to do the work that you need to do? Do we have the financial structure and viability to make your job easier? And Dean and I were talking earlier today, that's getting tougher and tougher to do. And as Richard will tell you, the legislature was not very kind to us this year again. Jennifer will tell you that it's because we had a lot of new legislators that didn't really understand the picture. And that's all well and good. But again, it's just that people don't understand our mission. And what one of my jobs and one of my passions, and by the way, I'm retired, and so I got a lot of time to do this. And I get paid a lot, by the way. And I got a raise this year because I was legislative chair for the state. I went from 0.00 to 0.00. So I'm working toward the comma. You know, when I get that out, it's going to be great. But my passion comes from the fact that you do so much great work with students who have all kinds of risk factors that people don't associate with higher education. When you have a student that's been out of college for 5, 6 years, they come back to you, you've got to start all over again. And look at our developmental issues that we have in our organizations. You have to start all over again. And that's what makes you special. You don't mind doing that. If they go to a four-year institution and they come in with those risk factors, there's not going to be a lot of support there. And I appreciate the work they do as well. But that's where the rubber meets the road in our role as community colleges. We are the ones that are basically keeping this country viable and the state viable. Without that opportunity being there, a lot of people would just be sitting around in very undereducated positions and doing very menial kinds of things. And so, you know, I congratulate you for that. And again, that's where my passion comes in. When I think of the demographics at the Alamo Colleges and where the demographics are going in Texas, you need to start really looking at what are we doing as an organization. So to bring it to the policy and the financial perspective, the Alamo Colleges have made some very significant investments in concepts like Alamo Advise. I believe, and I think our board certainly agrees, that without advising, you cannot have the increase in the positive result that you're looking for. I know Cynthia has been doing a lot of work. You two have been doing a lot of work in terms of isolating those components that are important. But we believe in advising. But if you don't set a policy, make a commitment as a board, and then support that commitment with the financial investment, you're not going to get the traction that you're going to need to make your job a lot easier. And again, that's a hard thing to do. I was talking to our young people back here from SAC. The state legislator cut us this year 1.something%, and to San Antonio, it translates to a $3 million deficit. And that's not a deficit. We can make it up through other aspects of this. But with our commitment to student success, we're going to make that happen. We're going to have to repurpose funds and work to making sure that the tools that the staff at St. Phillips and at SAC and the rest of our colleges can do their job and to do it as well as they've been doing it. I'm very excited about what they're doing. And the openness and receptibility of that concept of student success in terms of what the staff has been able to do has been dynamic. So if you have trustees that have bought into the student success agenda, which they have not only here in San Antonio, but statewide and nationally. And when you have that commitment from those trustees to translate to financial investments and planning, I think you have a healthy posture. And that's what we're leading to, and that's what we hope to accomplish in not only here in San Antonio, but throughout Texas and the nation. And now I'm going to turn the microphone over to these young ladies and see if they will give you a little different perspective.
Hello, my name is Cynthia Ferrell, and I am the interim director of the Student Success Center at the Texas Association of Community Colleges. And I want to echo what Roberto said. Particularly, I hope that you'll hear the message that we're all three going to communicate, which is that this is really about collaboration and stepping up our partnerships and working together is one message I think you'll hear. I think another one is how critically important your role is in making this happen. Before I went to TAC, I was an instructor. I was a developmental educator and taught a learning frameworks course, pardon me, for 9 years. And then I moved to teach in a couple of community colleges here in Texas, Tyler Junior College and Lone Star College, working with developmental education and working up through the ranks in administration. Did time, literally, at the coordinating board. working on developmental ed policy work there for the community colleges, and then have spent some time working with your presidents through their association. But through each one of those experiences, it was about student success. It was about collaborating. It was about how do we work together in order to create an environment where students can thrive. I know we're all facing some serious challenges when we look across our nation and our state about really when we look at our classroom and we look at individual students, sometimes we get our most satisfaction in the victories that we can help be a part of. But when we look up out at the landscape, we're not having enough of an impact. I think that's sort of the sombering part of our work. And so when we look at our country, there's not enough degrees. When we look at our own state, we lag behind in associate's degree attainment, even at the same time while over half of all jobs that are available require post-secondary work. So the importance and the impact on people's lives couldn't be any more critical than they are today. And then when you look at poverty in Texas, we had the state demographer, I don't know if you all know the work that's going on around studying the way our state is changing right now and moving to our minorities and how we are turning into a Hispanic, a very high rate of Hispanic populations, San Antonio leading the way. And when you look at how well we're serving these students, it's scary because we haven't been serving our students who live in poverty as well as we should. In fact, there's an overrepresentation of them in our developmental courses, and there's an underrepresentation of them in our associate's degree attainment. And so there's still more work to be done and that we need to do together. And so that's part of where the work of the center comes in. So when I look back over, I've been doing work similar to this for about 10 years, and so I took a moment and I paused and I said, what have we been doing then collectively to really address some of these issues in the last 10 years, and how might we take this moment in time to stop and evaluate and say, what should we be doing in the coming years? And so I know that a lot of your schools have been working differently in the last 10 years than you had before. How many of you have been in this game doing this kind of work for at least 10 or more years? Almost everyone in the room, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. Prior to 10 years ago, we weren't talking about data like we are now. We've really stepped up our game and become more sophisticated in the way we're looking at data and helping us understand our students' experiences. We have implemented more initiatives in the last 10 years than probably 20 years added together prior to that. We are piloting, we are being risky, we are trying things differently. No longer can anyone accuse us of status quo, because we are almost the opposite of that, the way we have turned ourselves on our head to continue to do the whirlwind of work that we always had to do while adding this extra layer of interventions and innovation on top of that. We have been courageous and we have done some hard work in the last 10 years. But I think that when we stop and we look back at those things, and why have we been able to affect some students but not enough students, I think some lessons come out. And that is that while we've been courageous, we haven't learned how to scale things up to affect enough people to really move the needle for the numbers of students who need us. So I think scaling, moving forward, we've got to think about scaling. And secondly, I think that where we're seeing our biggest issues are in our transition points. So when we look at the way we've been addressing, like let's say, a bridge program, we see a need, students are coming to us out of the high schools and they're not ready for college, and so we do a bridge program. But when we follow those bridge students into their first semester, they lose whatever momentum that they gained during our bridge. And so while we did a great job on whatever intervention we were doing, we weren't doing a good enough job linking that intervention back into the whole system of the students' experiences. And you could say that about any one of our interventions that we were doing. We're changing developmental ed, but then when they get dumped back into the college level courses, they struggle and they lose whatever momentum that they gained. And so we have to think differently. We have to work together to scale things up, and we have to connect our interventions more into the whole system of the student's full educational experience. And so that's part of my work at the center. So those of you who, does anyone know about the Texas Success Center? We're just an infant, we're a baby right now. So good, I'll start from the beginning. A few hands went up. So there's this movement going on in the country around establishing centers in states that will not be a new initiative. So we're not achieving the dream. We're not completion by design. We're not like a co-board grant that are going to give grants to a couple of you, but nobody else knows what's going on in that grant. It's not like that at all. It is grant funded. But its whole purpose is to try to help us pull together and learn from what we learned, learn collectively from what a few people learned in those initiatives, and try to help move all of our community colleges up so we can serve more students and do it in a more systemic way. And so we have funding from 5 different foundations. We have funding, even the community college presidents have chipped in to put money towards this initiative. And one of the ways that we are doing our work is through leadership teams. And so the idea is that we want to make sure that everyone in the institution understands what we've learned. There's no reason why each one of your institutions should have to go out and pilot each thing. But how can we let faculty know? How can we let mid-level ed managers know? How can we let vice presidents know what we learned so that they don't have to go out and pilot each one of these things? How can we let presidents know their proper role in helping to support us? How can we partner with trustees so that they can give us enough backing that we can go out and we can really make change, and we can do it fast, and we can do it for more students than we've done in the past? And so the way we're doing our work is through leadership teams. So I want to just very quickly give you a snippet of what 3 leadership teams are doing right now that you might be able to plug into or be looking for that's happening. We have a leadership team around college readiness. And so you may know that some of your colleagues from your institution came together from around the state and they built a framework for your college prep course. All right, so let me back up. HB 5. We're on the same page. We all know where we are and the kinds of work we have scrambled to do for HB 5. And one of the first things we had to do was partner with our ISDs, partnerships, and we had to help build a college prep course for seniors who weren't ready for college, right? We had to do that very quickly, and we had to make that offering in the fall without any guidance from the state. And so colleagues from around the state, faculty, and high school teachers came together and they said, let's build a framework. We know we're not going to create curriculum for each other, but we're going to create a framework that says, let's all agree that these components ought to be there because of the things we've learned. These components should be there. One being, we should let high schools know that higher ed is changing around our math, the way we think about math, right? That we no longer have only one road into math in higher ed, but that we are creating alternative pathways that are more appropriate for each major. And so right now is the perfect time for us to tell high schools, don't just train your high school students into that one path, because when they get to higher ed, there's going to be multiple paths. And so that's one of the ways that the framework is helping facilitate these cross communications with high schools. And so this College Readiness Leadership Team created that framework. We've been taking the framework around to different groups of faculty meeting with high school teachers to sit down and look at curriculum together. And from that group, they also are calling for a MOU. So you also know through HB 5 that you have to create an MOU with your ISDs. I bet there are people in this room who were the point persons for creating those MOUs. So from those framework conversations came ISDs saying to community colleges, quit making us go to each one of you to have a separate MOU. We're talking about the same set of students. Can you community colleges have one MOU where once one community college says this student is college ready, then all of you trust each other and value that standing? And so that's one thing we're working on right now, is creating a statewide MOU so that once a student is college ready by that college prep course, they're college ready with all of us. So that's one leadership team and the work they're doing there. Another leadership team is around transfer. Another one of our leakiest points is that students come to us, they take our dual credit courses, thinking they're taking courses that are going to work towards a degree, which may or may not be true. They come to us and they take core courses and they take transfer courses. And then when they transfer, they find out those don't transfer, and they lose a lot of time, and they get very discouraged, and honestly, they have a reason to look back to us and say, why didn't you have a better idea of the courses I should have taken, and that the credit that I would have when I get there. And so our transfer leadership team is looking at how we can reduce the number of excess credit for our transfer students so that we can accelerate their time to degree. One of the ways they're doing that is partnering with the coordinating board and working on, you know, that they are ramping up their advisory committees for field of study work. How many of you are familiar with the field of study? Okay, so creating program courses that will transfer. So just like the core, when you take them all as a pack, if you finish them, then they transfer without loss of credit. Same thing with the field of study work. And so we just want to partner very closely. And when I say partner, I mean I want to make sure that you serve on committees so that your voice and your perspective, that the community college issues, community college students' issues are represented well on these advisory committees, and that the work that comes out of that, and if we're going to guarantee transfer, that those guarantees are on programs that are meaningful to our students. So that's another way that we're partnering in order to support student success in the community college. Quickly, a third one is around dual credit. This was a really hot issue during our legislative session this time, dual credit. And the credits that students are able to take, how low we can go, our freshmen and sophomores are now eligible to take college credit courses in high school. And they can take more credits than they used to be able to take. And so our dual credit committee is looking at how we can improve the dual credit in all community colleges. And I'll tell you one exciting thing that they're working on that I think is going to be very powerful for us, and that is that they are partnering, they asked for a partnership between TASA, which is the Texas Association of School Administrators, so you're talking about superintendents statewide group, asked to have a partnership with TAC, the Texas Association of Community Colleges, being our president's group. And I think that's really powerful for all of us, because I think that the root of a lot of our dual credit issues are because we don't have strong relationships with our ISDs. I think I worked with the Gulf Coast Pass region. Anyone in a Gulf Coast school here? You may not be familiar with the Gulf Coast Pass work. That was all around partnering high schools and superintendents and high school administrators with community colleges. And we were so surprised at how little, at the end of the day, we knew about each other and each other's worlds. And so this partnership that we're creating between TASA and TAC is going to be powerful for getting superintendents and presidents together as a beginning, but also letting that connection trickle down in more meaningful ways collectively as a state. You're doing it on this end by building stronger relationships with your ISD, and we at the center are also doing that at this end, getting the presidents and the superintendents and their boards talking together about very similar issues so that we understand the constraints that we each have, and that we talk about funding issues together, and we talk about picking out the right courses that best benefit students, and we do that together. And so they've invited us to be a part of their midwinter conference, if you're familiar with what TASA does in order to keep their superintendents informed. And so we're going to be there, and we're going to help facilitate those kinds of conversations so that we won't have the kinds of things happen in our legislative section next time as we did this time, because we know each other better. And so I'd be happy to continue this conversation. I'm gonna pass this to Melissa in just a second, but I just leave you with the idea of thinking about the kinds of partnerships that we're building and how they, important they are to us moving forward and improving our students' experiences and doing that together. So that's the role of the center, is really just bringing folks together and help facilitating those conversations. And Melissa is a big part of that as well, so I'm just gonna pass that to her to tell you about that.
Sure, good morning. Again, my name is Melissa Henderson, and I am the policy officer for postsecondary education with Educate Texas. And I too want to echo my fellow panelists' comments this morning and just thank you for having us, and thank you for the work that you do on behalf of students each and every day. It's critical both to those students' lives and to the work that we do, quite frankly. So just to give you some perspective on who we are organizationally and kind of our role in this work. So Educate Texas, are any of y'all familiar with Educate Texas, formerly known as the Texas High School Project? Okay. So we are a public-private partnership of the Communities Foundation of Texas. We have been around for about 12 years, and historically a lot of that work has been programmatically focused. So we've done a lot of work around the state with districts and colleges around early college high schools, T-STEM academies, so we've done a lot of work helping districts and colleges come together to develop those types of partnerships. Policy has obviously had a role in that work all along, but it wasn't until about 5 or 6 years ago that we developed kind of a separate policy strategy within our organization to look at, okay, we're learning a lot around the state about how to better prepare students for college. From a practice perspective, but how can we take what we're learning from that and help that to inform policy? Texas is huge, I don't have to tell you all that. While we're doing great things individual campus by individual campus, in a state as large as Texas, you have to be thinking about the state policy role as well if you're going to reach large numbers of students. And so we engaged in K-12 advocacy at first, and then I came on about 4.5 years ago to start the post-secondary side of our policy work. Again, realizing we were learning great things about how to get kids better prepared for college, but not looking as much at what was happening to them once they matriculated into our institutions of higher ed, and obviously that's a critical piece of the work. And so as part of that, we convene a group called the Texas Student Success Council, which is a statewide policy and advocacy group made up of stakeholders from K-12, higher ed, business, philanthropy, community organizations from across the state. We also have had the pleasure of having the chairs of the House and Senate higher ed committees serving as ex officio members, as well as Commissioner Paredes and Chairman Alcantar from the Texas Workforce Commission. You are well represented by Richard Moore on the council, and so we really try to bring together as many of the perspectives as we can of the folks who are engaged in this work, be that faculty, be that administrators, be that college presidents, be that K-12, business, again, all the groups that I mentioned, to think about from a state policy perspective, we're all engaged in this work. How can we be working together to help inform state policy? And we're not going to agree on everything, and we know that. But part of it is, what can we agree on? What can we focus on together and try to build momentum towards? So there are four priority areas for the council, and this group has been convening on a quarterly basis for about the last 3.5-4 years. The first is around transfer and articulation. So again, as Cynthia talked about, we know that for the many of our students who are going on to four-year universities, there are a lot of issues around transfer. There are a lot of issues around not just do the courses themselves transfer, but do they apply to the major? And how are we making sure that those pathways are as seamless as possible? Because as you all know, we're no longer talking about the 18-year-old student who's coming straight out of high school, enrolling at a four-year university, and graduating from that same institution 4 years later. But yet that's how we still think about higher education from a policy perspective in this state and across the nation largely. And so we have to be thinking about what are the varying pathways that our students are utilizing to get from point A, entering any institution of higher education, to point B, completion of that institution, whatever that may mean for that student. So transfer is a big priority for the council. Outcomes-based funding has also been a priority for the council on the community college side, really, again, coming from the work of the presidents and the institutions coming together 2 years ago to say, this isn't just about enrollment, this is also about looking at how do outcomes affect how we are funded. So coming together around what does that look like and how can again this group of diverse stakeholders inform that dialogue. We've also introduced a workforce priority, and this last session that was largely focused on issues around House Bill 5. There was a lot of interest in House Bill 5, as you know, around career and technical education. And so we convened a separate work group that looked at specifically, again, those transition points between high school and I should also say, this group focused particularly through a community college lens. So particularly looking at the transition point between high school and community college and thinking about how can we take the foundation that was established in House Bill 5 and leverage that to create better, stronger partnerships between ISDs and particularly community colleges. So, for example, there's a state-funded grant program called the JET program. I'm not sure anybody familiar with it. That is focused on facilities and equipment for career and technical programs that has been open to community colleges in the past. And there are places in the state where districts and community colleges have come together on their own to create these types of facilities and access to equipment. And this would open that program to those types of partnerships as well. So where there are districts working with their community college partners, this would allow them to apply for those funds. So looking at things like that. And then the fourth area is what we fondly call our other barriers as identified bucket, or miscellaneous, whatever you want to call it. But it's essentially designed, as I said, we have 8 community colleges represented on the council, all of which are a part of an initiative called Texas Completes. And that programmatic work was just getting off the ground when the council was beginning to form. And so we wanted to leave a priority area to be responsive to that programmatic work. And because part of the goal of having this group of people come together, as Cynthia in particular mentioned, is that we're thinking differently about how to shape state policy, that we're thinking intentionally and deeply about what are we learning across our 50 institutions and across the state and nationally about how to do practice and program better, and how can we leverage that to inform policy. And so we wanted to be very intentional about leaving a priority that was intended to be responsive to practice change. And so under this other barriers as identified bucket, we've supported such things as state funding for the new Mathways project, which was funded this last session, and we were very pleased to see that. So those are kind of the four areas, priority areas for the Student Success Council. And we at Educate Texas work to convene this group,
help shape their agendas, help shape the policy recommendations, and then bring them together to help educate and inform legislators both in and out of session, working very closely with our partners at the center. And I should also say that that's a critical partnership for us as well, because again, what we don't want is yet another thing over here coming up with policy recommendations that aren't connected to the work that y'all are doing on the ground. So we're very intentional about how we work together to make sure that the policy recommendations that the council is coming up with and advocating for are very aligned to what we're learning from program and practice changes. So with that, I will pause and just say again, thank you for having us here, and we look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, Melissa, and thanks to all of y'all. So we just had an awful lot of information just thrown out there about what's happening. What I'd be interested in now is y'all's response to this. What are you hearing? What messages have been brought up this morning that you think are most relevant to the work that you do? I know one of the biggest challenges y'all have been facing, and it's one I think we all struggle with, is how do you bridge the gulf between the work that you're doing and what's actually happening inside of a college classroom? And so if you're sitting there saying, that all sounds great, where do I come in? Or what does that have to do with the work that I'm doing? That's the conversation that I'm hoping we can get to, is to help make that connection. Were there things that y'all heard from any of the three speakers that resonated with you, that you say, yes, I see, that's a pressing issue. If we could make progress on that, it would make a big difference in the work that I do. Anything that y'all heard that really stood out? Yes, ma'am.
The transfer and articulation.
I'm just wondering, is the work that you were talking about, Melissa, is there a council of educators from the four-year schools that are working with this council that you're talking about?
So on the policy side, we have one four-year university represented on the council, and that's definitely something that we're thinking about as we move forward, is how do we make sure that the universities are at the table even more so for this conversation, because we recognize that that's absolutely critical. Just as it's, you know, as we're thinking about dual credit, that it's critical that we have the ISDs and the community colleges at the same table equally on transfer. I would say it's, you know, even, well, I don't want to say even more. I would say it's equally as important to have the community colleges and the universities at the table for the policy conversation. But on the practice side, there are many more universities represented through the center's leadership team, and I'm going to let Cynthia talk about that.
Thank you, and I think that's really critically important, particularly around our new Mathways work, and whether it's ever going to work is by having strong partnerships with our universities. And so we intentionally built the leadership team with five representatives from community colleges and five representatives from selected universities that we wanted to come and be players with us. So at the highest level on the leadership team, they are having those conversations together. But recognizing that that conversation needs to come down and be all over multiple regions in the state, we also have the Transfer Champions work that's being led by the Dana Center, particularly targeting math conversations, transfer of math credits. And so they're getting regional folks together, faculty to faculty with university and administrators who can make decisions about transfer, having those on the ground conversations.
And math is a particular issue, or set of issues, really, because that I suppose everyone here may be familiar with this, but we're talking about making significant changes in the way we deliver math instruction, particularly with regard to major. So if you're in a STEM field, you might be in a particular math track. If you're liberal arts, you might be in another. And I know that a lot of our folks at community colleges are concerned that even if we buy into that and say, yes, these changes could be helpful, if the student transfers to a university that says, no, we don't agree with that, we want the same track for everyone, that the credits wouldn't transfer. And so just to put a fine point on the point that you're making, it's important that we have these conversations and we come to some agreement about these questions so that we don't send our students into a cul-de-sac with regard to transfer of credit.
Richard, the
in terms of policy and taking action on this, which is, I think, what you were asking, is we attempted to do something this year, and we've been doing that in the last two sessions, and that is to get the legislature to pass a provision or a policy from their point of view of a common course numbering system, which would help tremendously in terms of transfer. The bills have never gotten any traction. The Hospital 61 this year was sponsored by Representative McClendon Jones from here in San Antonio, and it didn't have any traction. The problem has been the flagship institutions. So what we need to look at is a strategy at the regional level, and we've got great relationship here in San Antonio, for example, with UTSA and A&M San Antonio, and that is not a common course numbering system, but the staffs are getting together to make sure that the pathways can transfer. I remember as a trustee, one night, this little girl was taking pictures of us during a board meeting, and I asked her, where are you in your program? And she says, well, I'm about to graduate. I thought, wow, great. Well, how many hours are you going to transfer? She says, well, I have about 120 hours, and I'm thinking, I don't know how many will transfer. When you look at that and think about losing Pell Grant eligibility, the amount of time they spend in our system, time and seats, and the cost of that, it's vital. And so that is a major, major goal in this state, just to make sure that there's a transfer aspect in this. But by the same token, make sure that you do something proactive in your organization to make sure the students don't wander around our system. So, for example, from a policy position, in San Antonio, after 15 hours, you have to have a degree plan. And then there's another check at 30 hours so that you make sure that those students are staying in track and staying within that 60-hour requirement for an associate. So there are a lot of issues being discussed there, but it still has not made that connection, I don't think, as significantly as it needs to be with the four-year institutions. Not that they're reticent, it's just that we just don't talk enough. We just don't have that link at this point. And though we're trying to do it from a governance perspective, it hasn't resonated.
And that's something that crosses so many lines where the channels of communication don't already exist. And in the conversations that I've had with our folks, there do seem to be two sets of barriers when it comes to transfer. One is that credits don't transfer. And is that something that y'all experience at your school? That yes, you have the receiving institutions simply say no, we're not going to accept the credits, even if they're supposed to. And then the other is if you have students who take courses, but they're not they don't have a plan, and so they're taking courses that aren't going to apply to a major, and it's no one's fault except that they didn't have that plan. And this is where it really starts to get personal, I think, because if you're a faculty member, if you're working with students, you know that if especially for our younger students, they need time to figure out what they want to do. I have a daughter who right now is at the University of Houston orientation, starting her freshman year in the fall, and she's trying to decide what she wants to do, and she has some ideas, and I'm encouraging her, explore, and don't know yet. You haven't had that class with that professor that's going to inspire you, so you need to be open, but you need to be moving toward a decision in a reasonable period of time. And so that, and I think if you're working with students and you know them personally, you know the lived reality of these issues, and it can't just be a ruthless efficiency that doesn't allow for the human experience. Yes, sir.
Yes. What work are you doing in collaboration K-12 with higher education? And I mean higher education, total higher education, with career components. What types of career components are we seeing, and what? Where is this being introduced? Yes.
House Bill 5 has caused a real ripple in what we do. And in the last 2 years, that's been something that we've been exploring. I don't believe that the ISDs were ready for House Bill 5 because it requires for some capital investment and so forth. So we've become the come-to place for taking care of some of that mandate. An example, we have the Alamo Academies here in San Antonio, nationally recognized. They're all in five career pathways, one nursing, one next aerospace, manufacturing, IT security, and now heavy machinery. Well, we take sophomores and work them through paid internships, and when they finish the program, they have they come out of that with a high school diploma, 30 hours or more of college credit and a job. So that's one aspect of this. But if you look at, it's very limited right now in terms of the implementations and the capability of people to do that. So again, that's something that we have started exploring with the ISDs. If you look at the posture here in San Antonio, and I'm looking at it from a governance perspective, maybe you'll have something more programmatic. Every quarter, the Alamo Colleges meets with every superintendent and president of their school board to discuss issues like the one you brought up. And it's resulted in a very strong relationship. When we first started this conversation with them, we had two early college high schools. This next year, we're going to open 13 early college high schools in San Antonio. And that's because of this conversation. The other thing too, which is, and I think this is a vital component, we just, or I think we're going to have next month, or it's already happened, maybe Dean, you know about this or not, and that is, we're going to have a counselor summit where all the ISD counselors are getting together with our advisors, and we're going to start trying to link up in terms of what we require and what needs to happen there in terms of counseling. So it is a component that's developing in terms of the ISDs and the community colleges, but we have the resources already in place that we can extend their implementations and support their implementations.
I just want to add just a short information in the middle of that, and that is the work that I mentioned about the statewide work and the regional work around building pathways with fields of study and core curriculum. Another role for us to be involved in that is to say, let's not have that conversation absent of endorsements. Let us build transfer pathways that transfer from endorsements to community colleges, to degrees, to careers.
And in the HB5 work group that I mentioned earlier, that this is exactly the type of work that we were looking across the state to different regions that were doing this type of collaboration around House Bill 5 and how to make House Bill 5 be successful, and trying to learn from the great folks on the ground who are already doing this work. What can we take from what you're doing in just the process of being good partners with one another and help incent that through policy? So there were a series of recommendations, including the ones that I mentioned, but also, you know, how do we take the MOUs, for example, that districts and colleges are already putting together around the college prep course? How do we take that and broaden it out to include things like counseling and advising? Not for the state to say, okay, and then you must do X, Y, Z around counseling and advising, but to make sure that folks are talking about it and that there's a plan in place around how are we making sure that our counseling and advising is aligned and on the same page, so that the endorsement conversation isn't entirely separate from the program of study conversation that students are having once they matriculate into our institutions.
Yes, ma'am.
You mentioned field of study. I've also heard of compact agreements. How are compact agreements the same or different from the field of study?
So I assume you're talking about like articulation agreements between individual institutions.
There is apparently a compact agreement for chemistry that is statewide. There's one for biology that's statewide.
So the tuning work through the voluntary compact agreements. So I'm not intimately involved in that work, but I can tell you how it relates to the work that we're doing. That was work that where particular program groups got together and they volunteered to create programs of study, right, or fields of study. And they had great success, particularly in engineering, in tuning that work. I will tell you that the first advisory committee on building, so now statewide endorsed, not voluntary, moving to statewide endorsed programs of study. They decided they would start with, the coordinating board decided they would start with engineering because they had so much momentum around that. I will tell you that when you move from voluntary, yeah, that sounds great, and maybe we could do that when we get home or not, to this is going to be statewide endorsed, it changed the conversation. And there was more pushback about the kinds of agreements that we could make, so it's going to be more long-term negotiations in order to, for that work to really become set in state statute. Anything either of you want to add to that?
Can you explain more about the student success program and the TSI completion? When we worked with our ISDs, we could probably get them through the TSI, but they wouldn't be able to be end of course exam complete, so they weren't going to be able to, you know, access their Pell funding. So has that been taken away about being end of course exam complete? And then you can come to college with the TSI, with the ISDs?
So are you referencing just specifically what happens in the college prep course and whether they're deemed college ready or not,
right,
based on end of course exam or the TSIA?
Right.
So right now it's up to the individual agreements, and so that's generally decided on with the MOU between an individual community college and an individual ISD, and those faculty are getting together and they're deciding, and so it's very unique for each for each partnership. A lot of them are using the TSIA as the endpoint of just saying, while we don't agree that this is the best way necessarily, but at least it's a standardized way of us having one measure for lots of different ISDs and lots of different students to measure. And since this is the way we're also measuring developmental students' college readiness, then we're aligning those two pieces. There are some institutions and faculty that feel very strongly about community college faculty being more involved in the actual curriculum and how it's delivered, and the percentage that is weighted with homework assignments or exams and participation or whatever the components are. And so they feel very strongly about that equals college readiness. And so that's really what the statewide MOU conversation is about. How can we align our agreements in such a way that we give individual autonomy and yet still have a group agreement about that once you say they're college ready, then we all will value each other's assessment of that and not stop students' progress based on whether it was a test they took in a classroom or whether it was a test they took because it was a standardized state test. Did that answer your question?
If I'm hearing the question correctly, because of the implementation timeline of House Bill 5, students aren't in the endorsement pathways. The juniors and seniors that were taking those courses last year and this coming year aren't in the House Bill 5 endorsement pathways and have different EOC requirements. So I think that's a temporary wrinkle that will go away as students come into the new pathways, the new endorsements, but I don't hold me to that. but I remember there being conversations during the college, as the college readiness leadership team was developing this framework, I remember there being a lot of conversations about how do you address the fact that you've got this course being rolled out for current juniors and seniors who are not in the endorsements, who are not under House Bill 5, who are not under the new EOC requirements, while also thinking about the ninth graders, I guess, now rising 10th graders, who will be coming up through the endorsement pathways and the new EOC requirements. Does that help? Right.
They are, you know, college, being ready for college. We will accept the federal.
Right. So, yeah.
It's a federal issue as well, but I don't know whether it's not been answered.
That I don't know. The federal requirements I'm not as familiar with. I know with the EOC requirements changing from the 15 to the 5. So they're the highest math EOC that a student will now be required to take and pass is Algebra 1, I believe. Because Algebra 1, Biology, English 1, English 2, and U.S. History, is that right? So those will be the only 5 EOCs that students are now required to take, the college prep course would be more advanced than that. So you would have to have a student who did not pass the Algebra 1 EOC and then later was TSI exempt through the college prep course, I think would be the situation. But I'm sorry, I don't know if that's helpful at all, but.
First off, thank you very much for all the work that you're doing. As I listen to all three of the panelists speak, I feel like I'm at the grocery store and I don't know which aisle to go down for what I need. When you partner with campuses, when we try to extend out for help, what are the nuts and bolts involved in working with a campus? Who do we contact? Do you put boots on the ground? Do campuses have to put in a financial buy-in to work with you guys? I just would like more information on that.
So I'll start with the leadership teams if you had something more you wanted to say. We just got back from summer conference with the presidents and debriefing on what happened in this legislative session and thinking about what we're going to focus on in the coming year. And so one of the messages that I wanted to send to them was that we have a summit coming up in November. And this is their way of encouraging, so I'm telling the presidents, make sure you fund your teams to come to these summits. And so we can translate, it won't be so much the grocery store, but let you translate what's happening at their level into what does that mean to us on the ground. And so I know that their conversations were very much like this. They were about pathways, they were about thinking more systemically, and the two big leaking areas still being college readiness and developmental ed and transfer. So those are going to be the things that we're going to continue talking about. But then one of the roles of the Success Center is how do we then translate that and to lots of different levels across the institution. So the next big way that you all can connect to that conversation is to come to the summit, which is November 17th and 18th. It's going to be in Houston. And we're going to ask you to bring teams of folks at your institution who are your point people for going back and making action around these items, the systemic plan, the developmental ed, and the transfer, so that we can give you sort of guided team time so that you can talk about the very question you're asking, how do we pick a few things and make them actionable on our campus? So that's how we're gonna help facilitate that conversation for you.
And from a governance perspective, it's vital that you get that information to your presidents and that it's communicated to us at our level, at the trustee level, because we're in the world of making policy and extending that policy to state policy and to national policy. So the more context it has from the campus level, the more credibility our efforts will have. And so I welcome that tremendously. In fact, one of the reasons I accepted this invitation from Richard is because we need that context. We're so siloed in levels, you know, and we don't really hear from you guys. I mean, I'm enjoying this tremendously because of that. I enjoy our presentations at the local level because that gives me some context to build from, and I learn from it. And so it makes me a more passionate advocate. So. All those things that you, the questions you're asking today are very important to me in terms of how I'm going to assimilate it as a trustee, but it also gives me the context that I need to make sure that I make the right decisions. And if that translates into the broader picture, it gives everybody the confidence to translate that into policy and to make sure the policy is correct and it doesn't inhibit the wonderful work that you do.
We've been working as an organization through our foundation, as well as the association, to bring the faculty voice to this discussion. because really for two reasons. One is I think there's an awful lot of information present here that y'all are can benefit from knowing about. But equally, there are things that you know that they don't know, and they need your wisdom, they need your experience, your perspective in the work that they're doing. And I've spoken, Cynthia and I have actually talked quite a bit about the need for building a system that allows for the kind of communication Dr. Zarate is talking about, where where the people who are making decisions have the information that they need to make wise decisions, and that decisions can be made at the proper point in the organization, that whoever's in the role that's most competent to make the decision needs to be making it. Otherwise, you wind up with these layers that don't talk to each other, and you get these unintended consequences because the person making the decision just didn't know that this was how it was going to play out in the reality, and especially where it touches students. They need to know what this is going to look like when it's actually enacted. So as an organization, we're very interested in facilitating that discussion so that we're all aware of what everybody's doing and decisions are being made with that kind of transparency. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I would like to see if you could address workforce, because while we know that some students are equipped to go to four-level institutions, some by either inclination or by design are not interested or can't. And so could you address that and what the state is doing to encourage and to promote workforce, increase programs, et cetera, funding and so on?
Well, what workforce is one of the most vital components of a community college in this state. And if you look at how we promote it through CTE, for example, or through our certification programs, it's a second tier thing, because we're still kind of mired in, we're the pipeline to the four-year institutions. And what we're finding now is that the workforce can be a pipeline to an associate's or to the four-year institutions. A lot of it has to do with students come in not knowing what they want to do, and the workforce aspect helps them find their way. And then they decide, hey, you know what? I've been doing college-level work. I can now move into that academic track. So there are a lot of issues being discussed there. A model is the academies that I mentioned earlier. We have students that come in and they get very contextualized in terms of, let's say, aerospace, and they get their certificate and the 30 hours of college. We're finding that a large majority of those students are moving into the associate's degree pathway, or at least getting an AS in that particular field. So those components are very vital. Now, without advisement, a lot of the students will go into the academic track and then do poorly in the academic track. They get discouraged with the developmental ed, whether it be reading, writing, or math, and they struggle. And so a lot of the information that I've looked at and what I've tried to assimilate is, if you contextualize the experience, especially for men of color, for example, which is what workforce does. You have the contextualization, you're going to a certificate plan. There's something at the end of the rainbow in terms of, if you get a certificate, you can apply it to your life as you get a job or whatever. It's meaningful. But if they get in the academic track, some of them, if they get in the academic track right away, and they go through the developmental experience and the basically not making it through that experience, they tend to leave us. And so there's workforce is becoming a more and more important component in terms of trying to get students to move through, get something viable for them personally, and then moving on to something else. So yeah, workforce is very important. And in San Antonio's case, in the whole state that I know of, every college I talk to, the component is very, very strong. And it's become even more of an issue now because of House Bill 5. Because of our need to connect with the ISDs to make sure that that pathway is available to them. And so again, there's a strong role there, and it's a role that needs to be recognized. When I first got on the board, when you asked us if what was our enrollment, we would only deal with the enrollment on the academic side. So we'd say we've got about 64,000 students. Wrong. We've got 36,000 students in the workforce involvement in our system. So that puts us up to around 90-something thousand in terms of students that we affect on a daily basis. So that's significant. And there's been a lot of significant investment by the business community into workforce. Every major institution in this city is involved in our workforce development efforts. We did a little exercise for the legislative session, and we tried to identify the number of partners that we have in this community, and it came to over 1,000 partners, and most of them were business partners, not educational partners or ISD partners.
Now, just a quick question. All the work you're doing is very exciting, and it is going to have an effect on all of us, and the summit's wonderful, but how do we stay current on what you're doing in both organizations?
Okay, so I was hoping I'd get a chance to answer the question even better. So the summit is the one way that you can send a team that we're already organizing. But really his question was, what can we do when we go home too? So one of those things is, how do you stay connected to what we're doing? And the other being, what can you do immediately when you get home? So I'm gonna answer both of those questions. One is, as you look at your students' experiences, what kind of data are you looking at? I think that this is one thing that you ought to do when you go home. I know that a lot of you have stepped up your game around data, but looking particularly at the systemic look around the leakiest points around college readiness and transfer, what is it that your data telling you about your students in particular? I think that your work is going to be more powerful and more intentional because of that data look. So I think that's one thing that I would suggest that you do. And the second being, what kinds of partnerships do you have but should be strengthened? How could you pull your ISDs and your faculty together more intentionally so that they come up with the solutions? So one of the ways that we, the center, are reaching out to make sure that this kind of information is coming to you, this is passive and not good enough yet, but in our on our website, you may know that we're in transition right now at the center, but our intention is for our website to be the place where institutions can come and find out about leadership teams, who are serving on those teams, what kind of progress they're making, what kinds of conversations they're having, and a way for you to link in and voice your opinion about those topics. But one of the ways we're stepping up our game on that point is that when we come to sessions like this, so when we've talked to, we've been at the Board of Trustees Summer Conference, we've been at the President's Summer Conference, we've been at the Vice President's Summer Conference, and now leading from the middle. And at each time I've asked, and so Richard, I'm going to ask for the center's sake, if I may send an email to the folks who are here, or maybe your membership, that has the kinds of information we talked to about here, so that they have record and they can pass it to others, and so that people who were not here could hear at least that portion of our message.
Absolutely. Yeah, we'd like to make sure we're helping with those channels. We've also talked at some length. We're partnering with several organizations right now to develop professional development, online professional development, for our folks to know what's going on at the statewide level, as well as other your peer institutions, so that you can know in some detail what's being done, what seems to be working, and how it was done at that college, so you have the information you need to do it at your institution. And as those resources are developed, we'll communicate that out to you.
And just briefly from the council's perspective, I would say two things. One, again, you know that Richard is there to represent you at each of the meetings. And you know, I don't want to say call, email Richard and bombard him with questions, but we can definitely work together to find the right way to make sure that y'all are continuing to stay informed on that dialogue. And then I would you know, it is passive, but we also have on our website more information about the council, who's on it specifically, the recommendations. The recommendations, because they are primarily legislative recommendations, are adopted basically on a two-year cycle. So we'll be working with the council members over the next year to 18 months to identify and adopt those recommendations. We typically we convene on a quarterly basis, so we typically spend each meeting dedicated to one of the priority areas. And we can definitely work with Richard so that you know, okay, I really care about transfer, for example, and their I'm just going to make this up. Their April meeting is going to be dedicated to transfer. So I want to make sure that I'm in close touch with Richard about, here's my perspective, here's what I think I would love for you to share with this group of people ahead of that meeting.
The key to this is your receptivity to new ideas. One of the biggest things that happened to trustees in the last 5 years was we were mired in, all we're doing is setting policy and doing the budget. And that's all we looked at. And through the good work of these folks, we started becoming data driven and looking at data and seeing the impact of what's happening with our institutions and trying to understand that data. And all of a sudden, the world became very different. But being receptive to all these ideas that are being discussed. And then plus, we did not have a state organization until about 6 years ago. And all of a sudden, I know trustees now from almost every system in the state. And that network, when I can touch base with somebody and say, you know, we've got this problem here in San Antonio. How are you addressing it? And it's not like the roof is leaking. It's like, we're having trouble with transfer. You know, how do you do transfer, or what MOUs do you have with the universities or whatever? We're talking at a very different level, because we're now receptive and very anxious to make sure that we turn the tide in terms of the ability of community colleges to have the profile that's necessary for them to continue to get the community support that they get. So again, receptivity is a very important issue. And then God knows, these electronic devices are incredible now. You can't stop working. When I was in Washington this last couple of days, I got two blogs from you guys, from this organization, and they were wonderful. And it added to my conversation in Washington. And so again, there are a lot of resources out there, but it's a matter of receptibility. If you want to continue doing the same thing, but you see that other people are doing other things, find out why they're doing it differently and see if it matches some of what you want to do. Receptibility is very vital in all this, because it's such a developing field right now.
I have a question for the group when it's appropriate.
Well, I'd like to ask y'all kind of turn the telescope around the other way when it comes to data. Y'all are dealing with students, you're dealing with faculty, you're dealing in departments and areas of the college. Where in your point of view, when you take the data that's being discussed here and you take your experience in your role, where do you see the biggest impact? I mean, if you could do one thing when it comes to student completion, helping students achieve their goals, what are you seeing that would be a real difference maker and as far as the outcomes for your students? Are there things that you think about that, boy, we really need to focus on this? If we could tackle this problem, we'd see a big difference come. What do you see where you are? Yes, ma'am.
And going into mainstream. So developmental ed, the TSI issue, and then going into mainstream, because we're losing a tremendous amount of students between dev ed and mainstream.
So you're looking at the whole stream that the student goes through and seeing how all of that's connected.
Cynthia spoke to how we keep the momentum.
And I think that's a very powerful insight, to see this from the student's point of view, that you're looking for the sticking points, and it tends to happen at the pivots, right? That each discrete initiative or element of what we do works. It's the transitions from one to the next. Essie.
Hi, I want to piggyback on her comment, but I want to back it up a little bit. I'm developmental ed and also credit learning frameworks. I would like to see a resurgence of boot camp, summer bridge programs. We already know who these students are in the junior year that are not college ready. We need to try to capture them so we can accelerate our developmental ed. So I want to, and also another point I want to make, we hear about the faculty, trustees, we hear about the presidents and everything like that, but there's a vital, there's one word that I haven't heard, parent involvement. And I want to know if there are any parents involved on your committees, any parents invited to the summit, because the parents have a great influence on these students in high school to get them ready for college.
And there's a lot of data to back up the impact of families on student persistence. Yes. What else? Yes, ma'am. Excuse me.
I'm also in developmental ed, and one of the things that I see that I think stems from both of these, but also ties into House Bill 5, is that students don't often know what they want to do, and they're not always aware and alert of what they're going to do until later in life. And I am concerned that the pathways will become a lot like the tracking systems of the 80s, where students are placed into them based on, well, you're probably not going to go to college or you don't have those skills. And I do worry what we're going to do with those students when they become 18, 19, 20, 21 year olds, and then they decide, I'm going to go to college, but they've been in those pathways to prepare them for careers that they've now decided they don't want.
And that's a real dilemma. I've heard a lot of discussion about that. We want, on the one hand, we need a coherent system so we're not just wandering aimlessly, but we don't want to have something where you're locked in at 18 and then when you're 21 the light bulb goes off, but no, it's the decision was already made.
Richard, can I address
that? And engaging them in the discussion, yes.
This is why advising is so important, and the linkages between the ISD's counseling departments and the advisors at the community college system. Your parent concern, if that can somehow happen, that's vital. And so you've got to take the resources that are in the ISD's, the resources of community colleges, and maximize that impact. And I'm talking because financially, from a budget perspective, we've got, if that's a vital component in terms of getting the students to be successful, then it must reflect in the budgets for both the ISDs and the community colleges. And we just had this conversation earlier today that things are getting a little bit dicey when you get cut every year, both ISDs and the community college districts. Some of that great outreach work is going to be dependent on the ability for those two systems to support what you have envisioned. And that's why we get to a lot of the, I think Cynthia said it better than anybody else, if we've made a decision to go scalable. We don't want to do anything that cannot go to scale. So you got to look at that first before you can look at your capacity to do something like, or capability to do that. But again, these are all great ideas. But when it translates up to the governance level, you've got to decide if you have the resources to do that. And a lot of people do not invest in things of this nature. And so that's why we are constantly having to reassess our budgeting processes in terms of whether they support some of these student success components or not.
And also, I think in addition to the counseling and advising is designing the system so that it can accommodate a student whose awareness is emerging in real time, having a pathways model that allows for exploration, where you can take that entry-level course, find out if psychology or geology is your thing, to move them in the direction of declaring a major and going forward. So that's important. So we're not putting students on a track that isn't suitable for them, but also where they're not graduating with 120 hours from the community college.
There's also the concept of stackable credentials. If you look at that and if you structure it as an organization, and even if you start out in workforce, you can stack that experience and move it to different areas, then you're fine, coupled with the advising aspect.
There's so many issues where we seem to be making progress and then we remember, oh, right, there are schools without those resources, or we need to talk with faculty. Wait, what about the adjunct? faculty, which is a much more difficult population to access, keep them up to speed on these kinds of developments. And so we need to be reminded of the hard pieces of this, the places where those resources aren't so available. We're running short on time here, but do we have other questions or observations? Anyone else? Good.
Just one last question. You were speaking earlier about the challenges that students are having once they complete developmental education and then they go more mainstream. Does your organization collect data on that statewide so we can identify specifically where those challenges are? I'm less concerned about students in reading. I think those students probably move on fairly easily. But those students who are in math and those students who are in English may have greater challenges. Secondly, I am concerned also about changing some of the requirements for mathematics, in which I don't want to suggest we're dumbing it down so that there could be success, but we're dumbing it down so that there could be success. And so I'm concerned about that, because at the end of the day, if that student decides he or she would like to move on to something else, we have placed some real limitations on those students. And are we placing those limitations because of that student's economic condition, or more specifically, because of that student's race?
All right, I'm going to take a quick stab at each of those. One, you asked about data. What happens to our developmental students once they leave our developmental? So yes, as a state, we are collecting data about that pipeline, at least when they fall into college-level courses. And even though we have spent 10 years playing around with innovating and being risk-takers around developmental ed, the truth is that even in reading and writing, as a state, less than a quarter of our students are passing their college level course after they leave our developmental courses. In math, we're still between 3% and 7% passing their college level course after they get through our developmental course, or once they are identified as being a developmental student. So we still have a ways to go with that, and tracking is going to be a key. Your second question was around math, and are we dumbing it down by diversifying the pathways? I think that algebra has long time had a privileged space in the way we value, the way we look at math, and the kinds of math some people can do. And we have undervalued other kinds of math, which are important for different career pathways. And so all of a sudden we're saying dumbing down when we're trying to be more appropriate for the careers we're trying to train them for. So I think we have to dial that into the conversation.
I have always had trouble and have been frustrated by the metrics that we collect in this state, simply because the template that we use is usually a four-year institution kind of format. And so that needs to be looked at. And I've said this to many people in the state that, yeah, until we get a collection system that collects metrics that represents the mission of the community colleges, we're going to have all kinds of different signals here. And so again, I've been, and I think the staff that's here from Alamo has heard me say this over and over again. We have got to disaggregate the condition. You can't just bring me a number of failures in developmental ed. You've got to talk to me about the age of the student that was involved, the levels that happened, that were involved, where they stopped or they didn't, and then it came back. I mean, there are a lot of factors to look at there. So metrics, to me, I think is one of the biggest issues in this state and in this nation. If you look at iPads and all the other collection agencies that are around, you get different messages from different ones. And some of them, iPads is in shambles right now. I think the clearinghouse is helping clean that up a little bit. But so again, metrics is very important, because I think if we get metrics and get that data, we can make better decisions. Now, in terms of dumbing down the math condition, in terms of policy, we need to find programming that matches the intent of that student. And if you couple that with, again, with advising, I keep harping at that, and making sure those students are making good decisions early on, then I think you're going to be okay. Now, statistics to me and the StatWay program, the other programs that have been proposed for us to endorse as a board, are just as rigorous as algebra. And I was shocked that somebody told me that the only reason we take algebra is so we can take calculus later on. If you look at statistics, for example, statistics have a contextual practical application, and that allows a student to move forward. One of the biggest things about student success that we've been working hard at as trustees is to not set any barriers there that are unnecessary and to erode those barriers. And I think that looking at different pathways in math and looking at developmental ed is a very important approach to looking at from a policy perspective in terms of this situation. And you know, again, going back to receptibility, and I just want to give you an example. I was standing right over there with Dean a few minutes ago, and we're talking about math, and I had heard a concept of co-requisite remediation. I talked to Dean about it, and he said, oh, okay. 2 seconds later, he came back after looking at his device and said, I found it, I'm going to look at it, we're going to study it. All of these, you've got to think outside the box on this. You can't stay with one pathway that's been determined traditionally for years. You've got to look at what is out there now. A lot of you people are doing some great work out there that needs to be shared and will enhance this particular implementation.
And the co-requisites is something we've been very interested in as well, working with NROC. Are you familiar with the National Repository of Online Content? They have some amazing resources to help with targeted interventions for students, especially in the area of math, to get them up to speed very, very quickly. We've spoken with the leadership of Texmatic as well as our math members about this question, because that was the first thing I thought of was, wait a minute, algebra. I had to take calculus as an undergraduate, and I'm not a math person. The message we've gotten from our members around math is that there's certainly discussions about it. I don't know that there's a consensus, but there seems to be a strong majority, certainly among the leadership in Texmatic, that providing a more relevant math pathway is in the student's interest, and there is enough algebra, they say, in statistics to give them the conceptual framework that they need for a college education. But that's certainly a conversation that will continue. It's something that I think really does need to be driven by the practitioners, and I appreciate you raising that point. We are dealing with a number of issues that create all kinds of challenges for us at every level. The way we evaluate, do you just throw out a number and say we're going to evaluate our institutions by some completion? Are we going to evaluate our faculty and say your passing rate isn't high enough and so that we're just going to look at the one number? Or are we going to dig into it and say, well, who are these students? Why is this happening? And let's understand the reality behind the numbers. That takes work, but what you wind up with is a better organization for the time that you devote to it. I appreciate y'all's interest in this. This is a very difficult set of issues to tackle, but it goes right to the integrity of what we do and the success of our students, and I can't think of anything better we could be spending our time on. In our next session, we're actually going to step back a little bit and talk about leadership. How do we engage in leadership, think differently about the ways we do what we do? We have a representative from Fulbright out of DC that deals with community college outreach issues to talk about how a broader perspective can allow us to think in different ways, thinking outside the box, thinking in ways that lead to solutions that we otherwise wouldn't have considered, and allow us to take a deep breath and reassess the approaches that we're taking. So let's take a short 15-minute break, and we'll meet back in here. Thank you very much. Thank you all very much. Awesome.